Hello, and welcome to Creepy Poem of the Day. My name is John Joseph Ryan. Throughout the month of October, I will share one bona fide creepy poem every day, as well as an introduction to the poet who created it. On Halloween, I will present the final creepy poem, providing you with a collection of 31 poems guaranteed to unsettle, disturb, frighten, and entertain. Please be sure to like and subscribe. Our first creepy poem comes from Chilean poet Pablo Neruda. At an early age, Ricardo Basso Alto changed his name to Pablo Neruda in order to publish his poetry without bringing attention to his family, who did not support his endeavors. But his native Chile, and eventually the world, did support him. As his career and fame grew, he served as ambassador to Burma, Argentina, and Spain. Following World War II, communism was outlawed in Chile, and the communist Neruda was forced to go into hiding. Many years after he was able to return to his country, he supported Salvador Allende, the country's first socialist president, who appointed him ambassador to France. In 1971, Neruda won the Nobel Prize for Literature. Within a few years of Allende's election, the rightist Augusto Pinochet overthrew the government. Neruda died within 2 weeks. While he'd been diagnosed with prostate cancer, the cause of death was listed as heart failure. His body was exhumed in the 2010s because of persistent claims that he had been poisoned by pro-Pinochet forces. The medical team that analyzed Neruda's body found no evidence of poisoning, but did find the Staphylococcus bacterium. Neruda wrote Nothing But Death sometime between 1925 and 1935, when he would have been in his 20s. Like the mysteries around his own demise, this creepy poem provides further paradoxes concerning the unstoppable might of death. Nothing But Death by Pablo Neruda, translated by Robert Bly. There are cemeteries that are lonely. Graves full of bones that do not make a sound. The heart moving through a tunnel. In it, darkness, darkness, darkness. Like a shipwreck, we die going into ourselves, as though we were drowning inside our hearts, as though we lived falling out of the skin into the soul. And there are corpses, feet made of cold and sticky clay. Death is inside the bones, like a barking, where there are no dogs, coming out from bells somewhere, from graves somewhere, growing in the damp air like tears of rain. Sometimes I see alone coffins under sail, embarking with the pale dead, with women that have dead hair, with bakers who are as white as angels, and pensive young girls married to notary publics, caskets sailing up the vertical river of the dead, the river of dark purple, moving upstream with sails filled out by the sound of death, filled by the sound of death, which is silence. Death arrives among all that sound, like a shoe with no foot in it, like a suit with no man in it, comes and knocks using a ring with no stone in it, with no finger in it, comes and shouts with no mouth, with no tongue, with no throat. Nevertheless, its steps can be heard, and its clothing makes a hushed sound like a tree. I'm not sure. I understand only a little. I can hardly see, but it seems to me that its singing has the color of damp violets, of violets that are at home in the earth, because the face of death is green, and the look death gives is green, with the penetrating dampness of a violet leaf, and the somber color of embittered winter. But death also goes through the world dressed as a broom, lapping the floor, looking for dead bodies. Death is inside the broom. The broom is the tongue of death looking for corpses. It is the needle of death looking for thread. Death is inside the folding cots. It spends its life sleeping on the slow mattresses, in the black blankets, suddenly breathes out. It blows out a mournful sound that swells the sheets and the beds go sailing toward a port where death is waiting, dressed like an admiral.